revving up our engines, and they sound real mean. Good morning from the heart of intense, focused endeavor here. Not to gain merit, but to extricate ourselves from the delusion that merit could possibly exist. Merit cannot possibly exist. It's impossible. No one has ever accrued a single bit of merit, ever. And this is astonishing, flipping the script, because historically we tend to be seeking for heroes that accumulate merit for us in the eyes of God. And to see now that it's impossible to accumulate merit in the eyes of God. In fact, that merit has never existed and never will exist. So flipping this script is the effort I've made on behalf of everyone, not to accumulate merit, but to liberate us from the false, absurdist belief that merit could exist. God created us absolutely perfect for all eternity, with no change in that whatsoever. How could we possibly then, how could the notion that we need to accumulate merit be anything other than absurdity? So if we want to entertain absurdity, we end up defending absurdity in absurd ways. And this is what's taking place. This is what we are doing. So the extrication from that is what we call the spiritual path, the path to cutting through the knot of absurdity. And we don't even need the merit of definition, or the merit of success, or the merit of no merit, or even the merit of now. These are the kinds of considerations that arise in our mind when we're cutting through this knot of absurdity. We're able to go further. Now, on the mundane side, got up this morning, and it's cold, but it's a nice day. It's a little chilly. Decide, okay, got to run. So running. About 16 minutes of running. And then I said, okay, that's enough for today. He said, no, wait a minute. Let's do some stretching. So stretching. And then let's do, a little jump rope. And let's do a little this. So just got to it this morning as far as limbering up, trying to build a little more strength, a little more flexibility. And so this is a reflection of the mental consciousness of let's try to get a little more strength and flexibility in terms of being liberated from the false notion of merit. And absurdity. The absurdist perspective. Let's gain more strength and flexibility so we can take even further rapid steps to liberate ourselves from that, to be liberated from the perspective of absurdity, the absurdist perspective, which is what we are all entertaining and suffering from. We're not trapped. It's like we have a guest in our house who's just turned the house upside down and is just causing misery for us, grievous misery. Well, we have to say to the guest, it's time to leave. Time to leave. This is my house. You don't exist. It's an imaginary guest. Okay, we have this imaginary guest in our house, which is advising us to do all this crazy stuff. And this is what's reflected here in this world. Our valuing of time is an imaginary guest. There is no such real guest. And this imaginary guest is telling us we need to accumulate all this merit. And it's never enough merit. And then we need to find saviors who have accumulated merit for us. We say, God, I can never have enough merit to please you. But this savior here, could you please accept, yes, extra merit that can apply to me? It's completely absurdist. Completely absurdist. Let's find someone who has extra merit. Oh, good, okay. When after I die, that extra merit will be applied to me. And God will say, okay, I can see in your account that you have extra merit given to you by someone else who had extra. So you get to go into the kingdom of heaven. But the ones that don't have that extra merit, they can't get in. Okay, this is completely absurdist. And I know this is describing what? Mainstream Christianity, it does describe it. It's completely absurdist. which is why I've had trouble here in this world. But you have to bring the truth into this world. And what I found is that the world isolates you. Absurdity isolates you and says, don't, ignore. Put them on mute. Put them on block. Doesn't exist. So, you know, the world's put me on block. They don't exist. If you try to bring the truth in, this is what they try to do. So we have to have humor, you know, humor and laugh, and that lightens us up a little bit. Say, oh, okay. If we don't need to accumulate merit, then why are we afraid of God's judgment? Right? It's like, oh, right, don't need any merit. How can I be judged? What was the fear? And the whole thing begins to loosen up. So it's like all these knots of absurdity, this massive tangled knot, this massive snarl of absurdity. We loosen it up. And we have to have the courage to challenge it a little bit. So I had the courage to challenge this entire system, belief system of absurdity. But, you know, they played hardball for sure. The absurdity plays very hardball, very crazy. And, but still challenging it. Hasn't been any fun, I'll tell you that. Not much. I've tried to make it fun. But the attitude of let's isolate anyone who brings truth here. This is absurdity too, right? Of course it is. Now, to switch gears here, as we've already taken a quick peek and said something which for most people is so blasphemous, they say, isolate this. No, put it on block. You can't say that. Everything is fine. Don't worry. It is true. I'm speaking the truth about reality, about God. There's no judgment. There's no sin. There's no needing to accumulate merit. Nothing like that. We're created perfect, and we remain perfect always. We can never, ever stray from that in God's mind. And we are an extension of God's mind. So that is the only law there is for us, is we cannot lose. It's impossible to lose our perfection. So the issue of merit never arises. It never arises. It's a completely absurdist imaginary notion that we have taken in order to try to be greater than God. That's it. Try to change reality. Switching gears. Talking about this world and the urgency of it. So it's important to hear this and not shrink from it. Because this is the real gospel of Jesus. So we don't want to have an absurdist gospel of Jesus, which is what we've been following. We say, Jesus is great. He has all the merit for us. He's going to save us because of his merit. This is absurdist. This is taking Jesus and putting him into an absurdist belief system. Jesus says, look, I'm not in that belief system. You know, I don't care how much you pray to me in churches. I'm not in that belief system. And you can never put me in it because God's not in it. And I know that I'm one with God. I'm an extension of God, as we all are. It all is. So we have tried for thousands of years to put Jesus into absurdist belief system and worship that absurdist belief system and believe that we've got Jesus boxed in and he's already back here in this world. And everybody has him on ignore. They don't understand that we've had him on ignore for 2,000 years, more or less. And when you have someone on block, have someone on ignore, like Jesus, when he comes back, you won't know it. And so I've been saying for almost a year, he's already back. Nobody gets it. Almost nobody. Not really, nobody. No one here. They just say, what? That's understandable, because we've had him on ignore for so long. But you have to get through that. Now, I have him unblocked. He's not on ignore. So I was aware. He said, I'm back here to relate with everyone just as a friend. And I heard it, and I said, okay, I'll do that. You're off block. You're not an ignore anymore, right? And that's all he's asking. Just take me off of ignore. You can't put me into absurdist belief system. I'm not there. None of you are really there at all. Okay, so the world The intensity, the issues, the trends, the convergence of trends is what we're concerned about. In terms of a sense of urgency here, convergence of trends is the issue. Not any trend by itself. And what absurdity does, it isolates each trend and analyzes and dissects it endlessly, completely ignoring the catalytic action of converging trends, And it's very possible that civilization, if you look at civilization as a vehicle, we're driving like a car, that it could, the driver could suddenly lose control of the car because of all sorts of converging circumstances. Now, we had something happen, a tragedy happen here with a family physician. It just got killed in a car accident. Her husband and her suddenly lost control of the car. Nobody knows why. The streets were deserted pretty much, and there was just one car going the opposite direction. They suddenly lost control of the car, swerved in head-on into the other car, both of them dead. You don't expect this to happen to doctors, do you? Think they're invulnerable? Well, it's doctors, medical society, pharmaceutical society, secular material society. We think they're invulnerable. They're bulletproof. Doctors? That can't happen to doctors. Other people die in car accidents, but doctors? No. They walk away from it. They treat people who have troubles. It's like a shocker. So what caused the driver to lose control of the car? Nobody knows at this point. It's under investigation. It's bizarre. But they were traveling. There was a witness that they were traveling at a very high rate of speed. So, aha, there's a trend. Going too fast, under too much pressure, maybe under too much coffee, maybe some drugs to try to smooth out some anxiety problems, or, you know, on and on and on. There's all these trends. Something converged. We have this fatal accident. There was convergence there. That doesn't just normally happen. You don't just normally, and it was not, you know, it's just not a, I travel that street all the time. It's not a particularly dangerous street, any more so than others, but maybe you might, you know, it's just, it has to be a convergence of stuff, a perfect storm of convergence. So this is a metaphor for the world. If there's all these trends, very, very worrisome trends. You say, wow, if this trend hooked up with some other trend and that hooked up with another, that would be really bad. Really, really bad. So we have all these very worrisome trends. By themselves are very worrisome. And yet when we start talking about these trends converging and mixing together and hooking up and catalyzing one another, then you say, wow, that could be a perfect storm enough to cause the vehicle of civilization to lose control. And this is what I saw in a dream, that this is what happens. The civilization crashes. It crashes. And from there, you go into a new world order. A very dark pit, or at least the illusion. Like it's a dark tunnel. You go into severe spiritual darkness, which means severe absurdity. This is what I've seen happening. This civilization crashes. And we think, wow, that can't happen. The doctor's driving the car. There's a doctor in the car. We have doctors. We have hospitals. We have advanced medicine. This civilization can't crash. It's impossible. Better think again. Better consider again. And so this situation, the tragedy that just happened, was, you know, it was like, wow. Wow. It hits home strong. A doctor-based civilization, a secular humanist, let's fix the body up civilization. We think this is like the highest perfect. It's too good to fail. It's too good to fail. It can't. Convergence of trends, boom, gone. So we better have Pure Land attitude. Better have reduced intensity zone attitude, Arizona attitude. Have Arizona attitude. Which means a reduced intensity zone, A-R-I-Z-O-N-A, a reduced intensity zona, okay? Have an Arizona attitude. Have an Arizona attitude, a reduced intensity zone attitude, all right? And you can escape the crash of civilization, and you can escape going into a severely absurdist new world order, all right? It's very simple. But you do need to recognize that the issue of merit is an absurdity. and that we did try to put Jesus and other teachers into an absurdist box, demanded it, and say, don't worry, Jesus, we'll worship you in that absurdist box, and you'll be happy that we're worshiping you, and that's what you want. And Jesus says, no, I don't want to be worshiped. I want to be free, and I want you to be free. I'm free of absurdity. We're all inherently free of absurdity. We're perfection. So Jesus came back and he didn't say, I'm here to be worshiped. I'm here to take charge of the world. He said, I'm here simply to relate with you as a friend. That's it. That's all he said. I heard it very clear. Now, an absurdist belief system is trying to destroy reality, claiming that reality is completely absurd and it's reality that's suffering. They try to project all the suffering onto reality. So when anyone comes into an absurdist belief system like this world, they're going to be attacked. I mean, the absurdity is going to try to destroy them and claim they're the one that's suffering. So, you know, let's project all our suffering upon them and kill them. Sound familiar? Yeah. It's truth that's absurd. It's truth that's causing suffering. All the suffering actually belongs to truth, not to absurdity. So let's do a scapegoat, project all our sin, all our suffering, misery, grievances, everything, project them onto this, to truth, and then crucify truth, and then claim that, okay, we're free of it now. Oh, great. This is an absurdist belief. So I thought, you know, people, everyone here that cried, help, help, we're suffering. Yeah, okay, I've got a compassion. Let's help. Let's see what we can do. Yeah, but absurdists have their own idea of what they think they need to do to get free of absurdity. And so they say, well, you can't teach truth. You have to help us get free. You have to help us project upon truth. I say, no, that's what's causing you the problem. No, you're crazy. You got to accept this absurdist premise. So they demand you accept an absurdist premise. And then when you do, then you feel vulnerable. And then so, but Jesus said, You could not harm a hair on my head. You couldn't touch it, you know, if it weren't given to you. In other words, if I didn't agree to it. Impossible. So you cannot come into an absurdist situation and agree to accept their premise and then be effective teacher. You're going to suffer terribly, which is what happened to me, what I did. The pressure here is so extreme. Maniacal. It's a maniacal belief system that's completely absurdist. They think that's your fault they're suffering. That's truth's fault. It's truth because they think truth is absurd. And they want truth to be like they are, which is really absurd. They think that absurdity is truth. Truth is absurd. And the absurd truth is causing them to suffer. This is how it works. This is the belief system of absurdity. It's upside down and backwards. Now, surely, any teacher has to see this, has to be able to see this. So, in Jesus' words, made it very clear he sees this very clearly. So I would expect help. I mean, we need help here. I mean, but my gosh, to try and teach in this world is brutal. It's, you know, it's the fault of truth, and they try to get you to agree with them that it's truth. Truth is to blame, not absurdity. That truth is somehow resisting absurdity in an unfair way. only hindsight will show me why, you know, I the help level has been what it has been. I've been helped to see it, but I'm still immersed in the madness of others' absurdity, blaming me for what. Not my fault at all. It's ridiculous. Absurdity blames truth for its suffering, which is an absurd thing to do. That's what absurdity does. It's always absurd. It keeps looping back to absurdity. It may seem to start out halfway Like, well, I'm trying to make halfway right, and but then always it loops back, boom, to the premise, right? Effects never leave their cause. And absurdity says, no, effects can leave their cause. Watch this. There's no point in watching it. It can't leave it. It loops back. It loops back. So I keep praying for vast help. Vast help is needed here in terms of support. Teachers have to, you know, have to be supported here. My gosh, otherwise, it's hideous. And again, absurdity, what we do is we never challenge the premise. We keep trying to find some way to blame reality for it. Say, okay, well, I won't completely blame reality, so let me start out not blaming reality. But then they loop back, find a clever, tricky way, and then boom, they're back blaming reality for it. And they just keep trying to find more clever ways to do it, as if that's somehow going to make a difference. It's just the belief system of absurdity. So the good habits we have are designed to help our minds become clearer and clearer and stronger in terms of cutting through this, the knot of absurdity. They're not an end in themselves, but we have to be supportive of a very keen and determined, rightly oriented mind. The discipline. And we have to do this work right in the midst of our lives with all this stuff going on. There's so much stuff continuously going on in this world, right? Hitting you. You have to do it right in the midst of that. And get bad news here, bad news there, tragedy here, tragedy there, this terrible, you know, outlook here. And yet, what are we doing? We're taping, and we're doing it right in the midst of all the struggle and difficulty. What else can we do? Most of us, absurdity says, no, wait until there's a perfect situation. So, we're supposed to be perfect? Well, I need a perfect situation in order to be perfect. No, that's absurd. We need to stop projecting absurdity in order to recognize we're already perfect. And since if we don't recognize we're already perfect, we will be projecting absurdity. And so we will be struggling. So we have to do it right in the midst of all this projected misery and struggling as best we can. And at some point we can realize we can go to a reduced intensity zone, which makes it a lot easier. Yeah, makes it a lot easier. But that too requires a commitment. So definitely need commitment and repentant commitment. And this is what's lacking here. Just spent 3 hours sitting in a reception room for a doctor. It wasn't for me, but and that's an ordeal. And so I'll just tell you a little bit about that. Everybody, different, the younger people, and not just the younger people, but most were on their smartphones the whole time. There's the other group, a little bit kind of older, that they're not into that, and they're reading newspapers and magazines. Me, I was meditating the whole time. Eyes closed, poised, quiet, meditating the whole time, contemplating and meditating the entire time. So it was a 3-hour meditation. And as you might imagine, the stream of people that coming in and out are, they're sick. They're all sick. They're all breaking down. They're all, you know, they have issues. They have problems. Everybody's on medications. And the conversation, there's some conversation going on, and it's amazing how proud they are of their illnesses and sicknesses, and then the medications they're taking to defeat those. And it's like, so you can see the sickness of the world, this absurdity that we call a world, is very, very apparent by doing this, meditating 3 hours in the doctor's reception room. Busy reception room. Lots of testing going on, lots of stuff. So this is it used to be that the sages would go meditate in a charnel ground where they burn the bodies, dead bodies. I think now we our meditation could be we just go sit in a doctor's reception room. And maybe it could be a big one. There are some I know that are big, and you know, so you could just sit there for 3 hours, nobody would bother you, just saying, I'm just waiting for such and such. And that's a very profound commentary on the madness of this world. Maybe even more profound than just a charnel ground, to tell you the truth right now. Really? I'm serious about that. More profound. Yeah, people die, the bodies die. The struggle to keep bodies going and the sicknesses and the medications and the obsessions and all this stuff, it's highlighted there, isn't it? Wow. And the number of procedures that older people are doing, they're addicted to it. It's an addiction. It's unbelievable. And the younger people having to pay for it all. The well people pay for the sick people. I'm paying just about everything. For insurance and insurances, and I never use it. I don't have a doctor. I mean, I technically have a primary. Never see the doctor. Haven't gone to a doctor in 30 years. Never even don't take any medication. Don't use the healthcare system at all. Don't plan on ever using it, actually. So the absurdity of it and the contemplation and seeing more and more layers of absurdity, it's just wow. And then calling for help, you see how absurd this world is, and you want help because you see, I'm trapped in this. I'm being blackmailed. I'm trapped. It's horrible. They expect you to go along with all this stuff. And I just saw how my life has been HY jacked and, you know, just imprisoned in all this. And so you cry out for help, 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 and then no help seems to arrive. You think, what's going on here? So you have to look at that. Two things. First, when you see how bad it is, it's pretty shocking. And this is why we have to get used to it bit by bit. To see it all at once... if we're not ready for that, no, it's too much. So we have to keep getting clearer and clearer and clearer insight into it all, into just how basically, fundamentally absurd it is, how fundamentally absurd it is, and how awful it is. And when you see that, you're so shocked. You feel, oh my gosh, I'm in this. This is horrible. Get me out. So the reaction is, please, get me out immediately. Now, why haven't we gotten more help? This is a big question. And it's a tough one to answer, but I would say that we haven't really asked for it. We keep thinking, that, well, it's not that bad. And then we get help, we think, oh, that's too much. I don't need that much. It's not that bad. I don't need that much help. And so it's something like that. I mean, it's pretty amazing. But the remedy may just be so strong that we're not quite ready to take that medicine. But really, when you see it that profoundly, you really cry out for help. Just get me out of this insane asylum. Right this instant. This is how I feel. This very instant. If it doesn't happen this instant, that's hideous. You could see how everybody here tries to turn the tables on truth and imprison truth and enslave it and make it sick and make it die. And it's just an all-encompassing belief system. Just self-devouring kind of thing. It's just hideous. So, yeah, I said, get me out of this instantly. But how do you do it? I mean, everybody, you know, it's like you gotta free the moth from the spider's web or something. The spider's angry. Ah, yeah, out there. So, yeah. I saw the old Indian lady again, walking past. I said, okay, give me a sign, Holy Spirit. turn around, at least acknowledge it, you're going to help. And then the lady didn't, resolutely kept on walking with her cane, walking. Then I look and say, where was she walking? She was headed for this hill. And she didn't turn back. She resolutely was making progress towards this hill. Well, what I see that as means head for the hills. So she's headed for the hills. And headed for the hills means to get out of harm's way. The oops, traffic. Uh-oh. I didn't expect that. Wow. This isn't good. Oh, well. What can you say? This is amazing. It's only 2. It's 3 o'clock, and it's just... well, jammed. That's bad. Really bad. Oh, well. Oh, well. More time to tape, right? More time to tape. Head for the hills. We're told, Jesus said, it's going to become the absurdity. Remember, there's only truth and then a false perspective upon truth, which is absurdity. Jesus said the absurdity would become so dominant, there would be a certain epoch in time and an era that absurdity would become so dominant, so entrenched, so ferocious, that even the saints, even those who knew better, even those who knew better were in danger of being pulled into it. And this is the time he said he would come back and take the elect of God, those who have repented, and take them to a place he's prepared for them, which I call reduced intensity zone. All right, the traffic's a little better now. Everybody rubbernecks there. Now, what is repentance? Repentance, really, we have to keep on looking at this, because we are told if you do not repent, you can never get into the kingdom of heaven. You cannot until you repent. Repentance really means to work on the familiarity issue, the continuity problem. That's what it means. Because anybody, almost anyone, if you explain truth to them, they can get it. They say, okay, I understand what you're saying. For a few seconds, maybe for a minute. But go back 10 minutes later, an hour later, next day, and they have absolutely forgotten what you said. It has disappeared without a trace, seemingly. Why? Continuity issue. They're not familiar with it. So this is what I've encountered. I can sit down with anyone and they ask me a question. I can clarify and give advice, but it goes in one ear, they nod, okay, I got it, then out the other ear, gone. So to repent means that you realize you have this severe continuity problem, because you realize, oh, I've been entertaining absurdity a long, 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 long while. And so that's all I know, basically, at this point. It's absurdity, absurdity, absurdity. So reason tells you, hey, I have a continuity problem then. I have a familiarity problem, a severe familiarity problem. And then when that dawns upon you, you say, oh, wow, I have to then work at it every day. I have to get used to truth. It's one thing to hear it and say, okay, I got it. It's a completely different story to then familiarize yourself with it to the point where you don't forget it at all. And ultimately, you're abiding in it. That's the real path. The real path is the path of repentance. Working on constantly, we say repent, change your mind, meaning get familiar with your new belief system, with the truth. Get familiar with it. So this is where we all have come up short here in this world. This was what has to be emphasized going forward, anywhere, anytime, any place, is the familiarity problem. And so the spiritual path is a lifetime. It's a career. It is a career. It's everybody's career, whether they know it or not. And all this other stuff they're doing is just playing hooky from their true career. It's just not doing it, not getting it done. And they'll keep playing hooky until they get it done. We have no choice but to ultimately drop absurdity, because we're children of truth and we can never divorce ourselves from that. So we must repent, meaning we must work on the familiarity problem. And this, again, this is what I have found is not happening. We think our education miseducates us and posits wisdom as some sort of sum that you total up, that you get the answer to, like a date. Say, okay, I know the date that took place. Right, you got it. Or I know the mathematical equation is this is the answer. You got it. It's we're taught to come up with facts and figures and things like that, and measurements. Where once we take a measurement, we write it down. We say, I got it. I'm smart. Okay, so we think that the spiritual path can just be measured. And once we take the measurement of it, we say, okay, I got it. And then that's it. Do you see how dangerous this present age is? The age of computation. Measurements. So, okay, measure it here, put in the computer, put some software, crunch it up. There it is. I have the answer now. I've got it. I've got some factoid. And they say, okay, done. Finished. Got it done. That's it. Nothing more to see here. Okay, this is an unrepentant attitude. So this age is characterized by a severely unrepentant attitude. Severely unrepentant attitude. I mean, I've spent my entire life getting familiar with truth. That's all I've done. That's what's required. That's called repentance. And how do you do repentance? One step at a time. One day at a time. Familiarity. It's just like that. There's no shortcut to it. There's no say, okay, well, let me measure my familiarity. Oh, okay, now I see, I know the answer. And how much more? Okay, so times five. Okay, so I come up with a number. Okay, I need that much familiar. Okay, I got it. This is a radical, radical miseducation that has taken place in this world. The world is being run by radical absurdists. Ultra-radical absurdists. And, you know, they pulled the wool over their own eyes so badly that others think, hey, that's interesting. I wonder what it would be like if I pulled the wool over my eyes that badly, too. I went, yeah, they pulled the wool over their eyes so badly, they claim, oh, I'm saved, this is wonderful. This is it. And the people say, really? Leading others astray. So even if no matter what we do, if we avoid repentance, we'll get nowhere. No matter what we do, if we avoid repentance, we get nowhere except bury ourselves in even more self-delusion and even worse continuity fear, which can never be defaulted on. White right now. It's getting to be late afternoon, and wow, I said maybe I'll go out and see if I can get some golf in. Cheap rates, cheap gas, cheap rates, late afternoon. So, super stressful day, sitting in the doctor's office, and no sleep at night. You know, it's just brutal. Seeing all this absurdity. Say, okay, so I'm all dressed in white, which is tough to do. You get away with it on a golf course, nowhere else, unless they think you're a nurse or something. But the white like this is in the Buddhist terminology, they have the five families of Buddhas, which each family represents a certain type of character and quality. And they arrange them in four, one on each corner, and then the middle, the fifth family, is the Buddha quality, which is spaciousness, the vast spaciousness. The symbol of that is white. So it's interesting that the colors I've chosen to represent, you know, the qualities I represent is this white. It's white with a little black trim, recognizing we're still in the world here, and pragmatism, necessary pragmatism. Perfect vision, but also pragmatic. But I didn't know that when I chose these colors. I've always tried to wear as much white as possible. I didn't know that, but that's what it's associated with as far as Buddhism goes. I understand that the white has this smoothed out quality to it. Lends itself well to the notion of you know, just this vast, pure spaciousness, mind seeing mind, because there's no merit to be found anywhere, no merit to seek at all. So then mind can then pay attention to mind just as it is, without saying, well, I don't want to look at you yet, mind, until I or you acquire merit. That kind of situation, the merit situation, is very interesting. Powerful tool there to use in your contemplation. Now, there's the other issue, is the importance to continue to go briskly on your path. Many stall out because they don't really tackle the premise. So they'll get familiar with enough spiritual jargon to feel like they've sort of satisfied that demand. But that's still egoic. Because then they say, well, I don't need to go any further. That's enough. I've done enough. Now, the familiarity is not an end in itself. It's designed to push us all the way through. So you do get, you know, just like people attend seminars and they listen. Oh, that's nice. Okay, I went to a seminar and somebody said something about karma and some of this. And yeah, that's nice. Well, this is not intense enough. This is not... And we can't get away with like an intensive and then say, okay, I've had my intensive for the year. No, every day is an intensive on the path. I've never had a day that wasn't an intensive. You have to make it an intensive. Another very interesting thing, that in the doctor's office, there's this dog. The doctor brings his dog to work. And the dog is running around. And eventually the dog came into the waiting room and was waiting for someone that went outside, one of the receptionist. And then the dog lay down right by the door and put his head against the door, blocking the door. Nobody could get in. The dog's blocking the door. And I'm just noticing all this. How very interesting. I've noticed how people are using dogs now. It's very, very, very keen situation in terms of the use of dogs. It's a defensive mechanism. It's a defense. Absurdity is relying on dogs now. It's part of its plan to protect us from what? From truth. The dog's blocking the door. Nobody can get in. If you symbolize the doctor's help, nobody can get in the doctor because the dog is blocking the way. And intuitively, I'm seeing this. It's hard to explain it because people are so virulent about, you know, this issue of dogs. And this should be a red flag to everybody. How people completely lose their composure and their rationality and sanity and capability of civil discourse and clarity and everything when you start talking about dogs. They just go right into the emotional mind, reptilian mind, right into it. And are unavailable for any other kind of talk. And if you're not rapturous about dogs, they're like, want to attack you. You know, so virulent insanity around dogs right now. Another thing is very funny. This lady was talking about, you know, bemoaning. She had a heart attack and she's bemoaning. So I got to be really careful eating this, blah, blah. She goes, but the most important thing is stress. She goes, that's too much. You got to stay away from all stress. And people in the room said, yeah, but how do you do that? She goes, I know, it's the in-laws. They're just brutal. Everyone goes, yeah. Children, it's the children and the in-laws. Oh, my God. And then later on, she comes out and she said, I was talking with the doctor. We were talking politics. And then she sat down, and then she said, I just love politics. I just love talking politics. And I'm thinking, well, I mean, is there anything more stressful than following politics? She's complaining about stress, and yet she's addicted to following politics. And then, this is really something. This other lady comes in, very different type, sits down. I go, huh. And then she's the previous lady said, yeah, you know, talk of politics. And she goes, I like Bernie. I think Bernie's really good. She goes, I'm a Muslim. She was a Muslim. She goes, I'm a Muslim, but he's a Jew. It doesn't matter. I really think that he's got the answers. Very smart, educated man. He has the answers for us. And the other lady, and they says, what about you? And she goes, Bernie Sanders. She goes, well, I'm a Republican. He goes, Bernie Sanders is terrible. And then it's like every guy goes, oh my gosh, the room's going to turn into a political argument here. And then she goes, Bernie Sanders, that's a joke. And then she goes, Hillary's horrible. And then the liberal lady says, yeah, I don't like Hillary. She's got nothing. She's got nothing. But Bernie, he's wonderful. And the other lady says, you should watch Fox Channel. Figure it out. Then you'll figure it out. I mean, it's funny because this other lady's like, you could tell she's a perfect Republican. You could fit type, the typecast. We're like, it's out of central casting. The liberal and the Republican. The Republican's okay, bye dear. This, like, you know, she's got money, she's got power, she's smart, you know, she's tough, but she kind of talks to people like, okay, dear, you know, like that. And the other lady's bemoaning her stress, but she can't. She's addicted to politics, and it's like, oh, okay, I'm just sitting there meditating, eyes closed. You know, nobody said a word to me the whole time. They ignored me, like I wasn't even in the room. Typical. Maybe it's just as well. And the other lady's going on about, oh, it's going to be a war. China's going to attack. You know, China's this. Everybody's worried about China and what China's going to do. Yeah. But the thing is, people love China because the people are so meticulous, materialistically meticulous, make good doctors. A lot of doctors are Chinese. Very thorough. They're very focused on the body. Okay, we'll take care of this part of the body. This, and people love that. Say, oh, that's great. I mean, the more focus we have on the body, the better. How do we heal this body? How can we make the body function better? Oh, this is great. So, actually, there's an undercurrent of support for the Chinese because of their extreme materialistic bent. This is what people say. This is what we need. You know, we need more of this. We need more Chinese doctors. Come on. So we can go in every single day and get tests and get, you know, medicines and have the doctor fuss over us. That, oh, they love it. It's like, doctors making a fuss over me. Doctors talking about problems with my body here, problems with my body there. Oh yeah, that's what, yeah, the problem is my body's the problem, you know. So the world is just bizarrely absurd, just absurd to the nth degree. And of course, absurdity can't realize this. And so absurdity is trying to realize non-absurdity or realize something. And it's insisting on being in charge of its own path, the path to realization, enlightenment. Absurdity says, no, I can do it. I can do anything. If I can dream it, I can do it. And all it does is it makes it worse. That's all it does. And then it goes to the doctor. The doctor says, oh, yeah, we can do something for you. You got this procedure. I mean, and looking at the procedures the doctor does, I mean, it's just so many procedures, cardiac doctors, specialists. Oh, my gosh. Just, you know, vast laundry list of various procedures. That's just one specialist. There are so many, many, many procedures. And people think this is progress. They think this is wonderful. Whatever's wrong, the doctor will fix it for me. And so I'm just sitting there like, you know, like I'm in the cuckoo's nest. And I am in the cuckoo's nest. And who wants to sit in the cuckoo's nest? I sure don't. So I said, Holy Spirit, get me out of this cuckoo's nest. This is crazy. I don't relate to any of this at all. I mean, I recognize the absurdity of it all, but I don't relate. I don't say, oh, this is what I want. This is wonderful. I just say, no, this is madness. So, no wonder why the teachers haven't made much headway. I see it, you know. I got to be more understanding of them. Because I thought, wow, maybe they should have done a better job. It's like, not so fast. Absurdity just insists that all references continue to loop through absurdity. All efforts must loop through absurdity. Must be based on, you know, within the advice of absurdity. So how can we get anywhere? We just spin our wheels. People are talking about all their, you know, the ailments, the this and that, and then, oh yeah, but I'm top. Oh, what's your this? Oh yeah, I got. Oh, that's. It's like, you know, they feel special. They feel very special. And if they ask me, nobody ever asked me, I'd say, well, I'm perfect. And people say, how dare you say such thing? You know, what an arrogant person. I'm perfect. Yeah, I'm perfect. My mirror's a little foggy, so it's not reflecting it properly, but I'm perfect, and I plan on reflecting that. But you never hear that in public. You never hear what you need to hear in public. Now, we don't need to assess absurdity. All of absurdity is just absurdity. I mean, there's no need to. The specific forms that absurdity plays as doesn't matter. Why could it possibly matter? The remedy is still the same. Absurdity is still the same. So what matters is the remedy for absurdity, not chasing after the ever-changing phantasmagoria that absurdity churns out. That doesn't profit anything. We don't need to be aware of all the Holy Spirit's aware of everything. We don't need to be aware of it. Of all the various deceits that absurdity is trying out, because at its root, it's all the same. It's all the same. We just need to see the sameness of it. That's what we're not seeing. The camouflage, it makes us think it's not all the same. It's all the same. It's all the same. As the gurus say, there's nothing happening here. There's nothing at all happening here. It's all the same. And we say nothing happening, meaning it's just sameness. There's nothing different happening, is another way of putting it. There's nothing different. It's just all absurdity happening here. Nothing new happening here. Nothing new is happening here. Just absurdity. The dance of absurdity is happening here. And it's always the same. It's always the same absurdity. It's not some other absurdity. There isn't some other absurdity. It's just absurdity chasing its tail. And absurdity say, I gotta get rid of that other absurdity. Look at that tail. It's absurd. Why does it keep fleeing from me? And it's just, the dog is chasing its tail. The dog of absurdity is just chasing its tail. That's it. It's the same absurdity. It's all the same. There's only one absurdity. It's all the same absurdity. It doesn't matter how it dances. It's the same skeleton of absurdity dancing. It can never dance the right dance, absurdity. It's a wrong view. A wrong view of reality will never be real. Will never be right. A wrong view of reality will never be right. And how does it become right? It doesn't become right. Reality is already right. So a wrong view of reality will always be simply a wrong view of reality. Absurdity will always be simply absurdity. We don't transform absurdity. We don't sanctify absurdity. We don't do any of that. Absurdity will always be absurdity. A wrong view of reality will always simply be a wrong view of reality. And only our continuity fear makes us think that we need to do something else about it. Interesting. So much today, Shobi started talking with me, and he had this, talking about his car he has. It's an oldie, beautiful vintage car. And he said that he had a previous one, and somebody totaled it. He lent it to a younger person, and the younger person drove it off a freeway off ramp and fell down to a parking lot and completely smashed another car along with his car and ruined it. And he got $30,000 out of that for insurance. And then he's able to buy another vintage car in perfect, just wonderful vintage condition for a lot less money. So he showed me the picture of it and everything. It's a 1965 cherry red convertible. And I said, this is interesting, you know. Getting something's like in great, great condition, going back to a time when we were less addicted to time. Less addicted to materialism. When we're talking about how the days in 1965, how it was so much, you know, smoother and easier, and it wasn't nearly as, it wasn't nice. I mean, it's still hell, but still absurdist hell, but not as intense as right now. And so the symbology is interesting about how something gets wrecked, but that leads to something else being getting better, something better. Beautiful, beautiful color. The color of the car. It's a beautiful looking car. Just amazing. So, this civilization gets wrecked, but we go to a reduced intensity zone because of this is coming and happening, and we get something that's way better, way better, way better. And how did he get wrecked? He said he lent his car to the young person. And the young person immediately wrecked it. What have we done with this culture except turn it over to youth? Okay? Turn it over to youth. When you turn culture over to youth, the youth wreck the culture. They wreck it. Because there's no wisdom. Repentance is something that takes a lifetime. You need the elders who have repented. This is the storehouse of wisdom. The youth haven't repented. Unless they've done it in previous lifetimes, which is, you know, pretty unlikely for most of us. Because once you really repent, the chances are you won't be coming back here. So we have completely messed up. We lent our car, our civilization, this world, to the young, youth. We sold out to youth thinking, this advertising. This was intentional by the interlopers, cosmic corporate culture. They knew that when you turn culture and civilization over to youth and cut off the elders, and so through advertising and marketing and education and demonizing elder people, etc., you're cutting yourself off from the wellspring of knowledge, wisdom born of repentance. Wisdom that it comes from repentance. And repentance is, again, what? Working on familiarity every single day. For a long, long time, you work on that. And the more you work on it, the clearer you get and the more wisdom you get. And so, you see what a trap this is by turning the culture over to youth? It's a disaster. This is why I'm saying these trends in the world are disastrous here. There's no wisdom anymore. Nobody listens to the elders. Speaking as a truism. And they're just going on, thinking that youth has the answer. What answer do they have? Giggles? Working hard on caffeine and drugs and playing video games and youth has the answer? I find the youth of today to be very extremely shallow. Extraordinarily shallow. But this is the problem. They're superficially sophisticated, but extraordinarily shallow, with almost no depth at all to them. You can't speak with them philosophically, in-depth psychology, you know, spiritual in-depth. You cannot speak it with spiritual depth to most. Of course, there's some anomalies there out there. Those who have done some work in past lives, who have done some work of repentance. But speaking in terms of truisms here. This is a very strong truism here. Now, truism means it will mean, of course, that this is a very important trend to be aware of. Dangerous, 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 ruinous trend. The elders would tell you, spend your time in repentance. It's all important. The wise elders. Throughout history, the wise elders had always held a very important position in civilization and culture. And when that is lost, it's a disaster. Because they will counsel, the cooler heads prevail. Cooler heads prevail. They say, look, it's not worth, you know, you trying to be like this aggressive and trying to, it's not worth it. That's ruinous. Spend your time taming, you know, the emotions and the passions and the desires and the absurdities. And know yourself. Put your effort to try to know what is really important. You know, all the virtues and the admonitions and the advice that passed down from elder to elder throughout the culture, we've cut ourselves off from that entirely. Another truism. Everywhere I go now, all I see is the youth just looking at their smartphones. Another truism. I just see a skateboarder going by there. Okay, skateboarding. Youth. Okay, fine. Skateboarding's fun. Wonderful. He's got earbuds in, and he's got his smartphone there. So he's listening to music while he's skateboarding, okay? And he's also watching like some video or something as he is skateboarding. So basically, there's like no activity that they do these days, the youth, where they're not looking at their smartphones, where they're not playing some game, looking some, you know, horrible content. I'd say about 99.99% of all content that I see in the world is utter trash absurdity. It's almost impossible to find any good content here in the world. So they can't be looking at anything helpful, really. Not really. Superficial, a lot of superficial stuff that maybe has some gloss. But real helpfulness, that really brings wisdom, it really brings repentance, that's focused, that's a repentant-focused content, a repentance-driven content. How much of that is there really, and how much is the youth really paying attention to that? They say that a vast percentage of people, once they graduate from high school, abandon religion now, young people. I can't remember what the percentage was. It was enormous, like 90%. Over 90% of young people, by the time they graduate from high school, they have left the religion of their parents. They've left, yeah. In other words, they're not listening to their elders anymore at all. Not listening to the elders anymore at all. They are listening to their smartphones. And who is it that is programming and controlling those smartphones? Now, we had to call AAA yesterday, and they said, wait on the phone, and we will determine your location by your phone. Well, I waited a long time because I don't have a smartphone. After a long time, they said, we may need additional information. Right. That was good to know. It's a disaster, this world. The shallowness, I mean, sure, people are still seem to be functional. It's very shallow. It's unrepentant. This leads to greater and greater absurdity. And the inability to tell the difference between absurdity and truth. And the belief that absurdity is true. And that truth is just an absurdity. A mythical mental illness absurdity. And then back to their smartphones. And we're placing our faith and trust in our destiny and our salvation in these youth. If that is absurdity, what is? And yet absurdity is saying, yes, that's how you get saved. Of course they say that, because those are the chosen golden children of absurdity. And absurdity is so proud of them and saying, these children will lead you to what absurdity wants, to the absurdist salvation. And so we're thinking, oh my gosh, I got to follow along, I guess. I don't want to rock the boat. I mean, no, no, and no. It's, don't follow along then. Do not follow along. I came across one person yesterday where they said, I don't have a cell phone. I refuse to even have a cell phone. If someone wants to call me on my home phone. And we'll talk. Older person, we'll talk. We don't just text. Text this. You want to communicate with me? Talk with me so I can talk with you back and forth here. And get all the nuances. The tone of voice, the volume of the voice, the quality of the voice, the rapidity of the voice, all the nuances of communication. It's better in person to talk with someone because they get all the body language in it, all right? But no, just a flat text. Just get a little flat text. Oh, but I threw an emoticon in there. Oh, wow, see, I'm really communicating there. It's horrible. So this has produced a wow. Looking at this now, you reach a certain point, you feel, oh, I can't seem to say much more. I feel like, wow, what's wrong? Well, it's shock. It's shock of realizing how we've been tricked and trapped and we're following the wrong, the wrong way. Following the youth. This world is going, a coup is going to take place. It's really a coup in many ways. It's a multi-level coup, but it will be a coup. And I don't want to say what it is. We'll find out. Won't be surprising when it happens. Wow. And you got some senile man telling the kids what they want to hear, saying, kids, you're the future. You know the answer. These older people, they don't know anything. You got this socialist saying, come on, kids, it's your time to take over. You know, you're the answer. You're the future. And the kids just eat it up, of course. He's, demagogue, playing right to the audience there. Shameful. It used to be the adults could tell the kids, you kids don't know anything. Wait until you learn some of life's lessons here. And the kids said, no, we know it all. We know it all. We can do it all. The folly of youth. Is extreme. Youth tends to overwhelm our reason. It's brutally difficult. I had a hideous time going through youth. Hideous time. Hated it. Because it definitely distracts us from clarity and reason in a terrible way. It's very distracting. I wanted to be old when I was young. I wanted people to listen to me. I said, look, I'm a wise elder, listen to me. Some people said, no, you're not, you're just a little kid, shut up. So in my case, it's a different story. Because the adults then said, look, we got the wisdom, old. And I said, yeah, you do, that's great, and I agree with you. So they did treat me, older people did treat me pretty well. They had some respect for me, because I listened to them. Paid attention to them, I respected them. But the overall culture, no way. It was youth revolt, and it's been going on ever since. And now, most of the, maybe over half the world will soon be under 30, 33 or 35 or whatever. I mean, and they're going to take over. There's going to be a coup. Of course, they'll be manipulated by the reptilians. Too stupid and too distracted to really care about this. Well, I just had one of the more interesting experiences of my life. Teed off at 3:40, finished the round at 5:42, our round. That's not what was interesting. I was on the second tee, and this strange-looking lady comes walking up a sidewalk. The tee box is near a sidewalk. And I wanted to say hello to her, but she wasn't quite to the tee box yet. So I said, okay, I'll go ahead, and I won't say anything. And so I see her kind of walk by, and I turn my back, and I put the ball down, tee it up, and I take a practice swing, like I normally do. I take a nice practice swing, loosen up, and I hear some sound saying, whoops, whoo, whoo, like that. And I say, what? And I look, and she's standing there watching me. I say, what kind of reaction is that? I don't know. So I said, it's kind of disturbed. So I said, I'll take another practice swing here. Got to set up, get the setup, get the aim. Took another nice practice swing. And this time, she burst out in laughter. Just gales of laughter. And just trying to cover her mouth. And she was just thought it was the funniest thing in the world. And I said, wow. And then, so she thought I was trying to hit the ball. She didn't know about practice swings. So she thought I was just missing the ball entirely. And she just thought it was the funniest thing in the world. And then I stepped up and hit the ball nicely. But she had walked on by that time. So I was like, this was like a very, very odd situation. So instead of getting upset or flustered, I said, wow, this Holy Spirit's trying to get my attention here. This is amazing. What is going on here? So I continued to play, and I was a little bit out of sorts. And somewhere through the round, about halfway through the round, I was wondering, what did that mean? What did that mean? And it clicked into place in my mind. Stop taking any practice swings. Just step up to the ball and just hit it. And I said, can that possibly be that? You know, I'm going to... Why? You know, so I'm thinking of this. And a whole new sort of perspective clicked into place. So the rest of the round, all I did was I just teed the ball up, stepped up the ball, wham. Ball's out in the fairway, step up, no practice swings, nothing, just step up and just hit it. Step up and hit it. And I just breezed. It's the easiest round I've ever played in my life. Just breezed through it. Not flustered, not tired, nothing. It was just astonishing. Now, I didn't always hit it perfect or the best, but you know what? Here's the interesting thing. Many levels to this. Many levels. Before we dig into this, I'm actually leaving the course, driving home now. And I didn't even break a sweat. You know, it was just incredible what happened there. And I said, you know, this was a strange looking lady. Big sunglasses, hat, small, big coat. I mean, it was just, I said, who is this? What kind of person is this? I don't know. So who was that? I don't know. You know? Was that some guru? You know, she just showed up there. And because the insight that triggered was extremely profound. Now, at the level of golf, it was just a different way to play golf. And the truth of the matter is you're going to hit some good shots and you're going to hit some bad shots out there, no matter what. And what looks better out there? I mean, what feels better? What looks better? If you just step up to the ball, no practice, no hesitation, and just drill a great shot, that feels really, really good. What happens when you step up to the ball and you take all these practice swings, you back off the ball, you align yourself, you're all nervous, you're sweating, you're grinding, you say, I gotta, you know, really working hard at this, and you hit it, slice it out of bounds. That's the most demoralizing event there is. Now, if you just step up to the ball, just swing, boom, and you happen to hit out of bounds, which I did, this time I said, didn't even matter, okay, and not even go look for the ball. Forget it's gone. Just go drop one. Just play on like nothing happened. There's no problem at all. It doesn't hurt. It doesn't hurt nearly as bad. So the good shots feel way better than if you're grinding over a shot and hit a good shot. You go, whew, like, wow, really, what a relief. I didn't mess up there. Good. So actually, it's way easier on your nerves to not even bother about grinding over the shot. And I hit probably more good shots just playing fast and not even, hardly even assess it. I just, okay, what's the yards here? Let me line it up. Boom, swing, done. Hit a lot of great shots. Came in very, very strong. Made a birdie on 17. Just a lot of the holes just played extremely well. Par, birdie, you know, coming in like that. And it's a revelation. Now, if you play that way, people will then just assume you just absolutely know what you're doing. And if you hit a bad shot, well, everybody hits a bad shot. You know, who cares? You're not trying to be a pro anyway. And you hit enough, so it helps your confidence way more than struggling over every shot, lighting up putts. Like I just step up to the putt, just walk up to it, step up to it, look at it, hit it. No practice swings, nothing. And I actually put it better that way. So if you're playing that way, people will just see, wow, you know, it's easy for them. Easy. We don't even have to try hardly. Not even grinding, not even struggling one bit. It's amazing. And I feel like I didn't even struggle at all. Didn't even struggle out there. Where normally it's just a huge struggle. And the results were even better. Okay, so that's the pragmatic, superficial level of it all. Deeper level, I got the deeper spiritual message. No practice. No practice. It's practice that messes us up. However, there's a caveat here, and that is, we need to practice not practicing. Okay, it's like the mind said, I need to gain merit. Therefore, how do I gain merit? Oh, I need to do all these spiritual practices. And so we deluded ourselves so we could do spiritual practices to try to gain merit. How about that? Wow. So just drop all practice, and you're in abundance. And I hit some fabulous shots out there. Just fabulous, with no practice, swings, nothing. Just stepping up, settling in, pulling the trigger. Boom. Fabulous shots. And I just, it was so quick. Just pick up the tee, walk the cart, go. You know, it takes about 20 seconds, I'm done. So this lady, this strange-looking woman, could have been the queen of the Dakinis right there, you know. Herself, actually. Who knows? I mean, if someone went to look for her, she may have just disappeared. Somebody may say, I've never seen anyone like that. What are you talking about? I mean, for all I know, that was just a manifestation, an appearance. See, we don't know. We don't know how often these great gurus are appearing to us. We don't know, because oftentimes they don't appear as some divine being, but as just some odd person that triggers something. Why do we assume that they're going to appear like their pictures or the paintings of them? And so you can say, oh, I know who you are. Oh, you're a great saint. How do we know that they just don't, they're not somebody just walking down the street that triggers something? And then they go around a corner at some point. They just have a way of just disappearing, vanishing. We don't know. They could be appearing quite a bit, actually. I've had quite a few situations similar to this where somebody that I just felt like, this person is just odd. I am the way they're acting, it just, And then it ends up triggering some tremendous breakthrough. And this one was just the mother of all breakthroughs. I mean, it was just extraordinary what happened. And I didn't get mad. You know, I was able to handle my emotions. I mean, this thing, I mean, it almost, I mean, I struggle with it, because for somebody to laugh at you like that when you're taking practice swings means they're completely ignorant of the game. And you never laugh at somebody on a golf course. That's a complete taboo to do that. And why would they burst out in high laughter, you know, if somebody awkwardly missed a shot? I mean, they'd say, oh, you know, it's like, oh, wow, you know, that's too bad. But, I mean, it was just, the whole thing was so over-the-top surreal, actually, if you add everything up. Why would she stop right there and be just watching me like that? Ordinary people don't do that. So everything she did was extraordinary, out of the ordinary, way out of the ordinary. And it ended up being exactly what I needed to experience to trigger a complete flipping the script in my life. I mean, I'll never be the same after that. I found out I can play this way. I don't have to practice. Now, you have to know what you're doing to an extent, some extent, to get away with that. And also, I was dressed apart. I was dressed apart, so I just walked like I was just breezing. It was just a breeze. I mean, I'm just out here for some little exercise. This is like super easy for me. Super easy. Not even have to try. Step up, hit it. It's right in the middle. Beautiful shot. Oh, well, you know. It made the birdie, just didn't say nothing, just went and picked the ball up. It's like, oh hum. Everything was just easy. Just out here, just taking it easy. Completely opposite. Most rounds of golf for most people are just like a trip to the torture chamber. Just sweating. Oh my gosh, I don't know what I'm doing, but let me just hit this, wham. Okay. Wherever the shot landed, I acted like that's perfectly fine. No problem at all. Perfectly fine. Just step up. Hit the next shot. Perfectly fine. Step up, hit the next shot. So in other words, no, I never gave any indication that any shot was any trouble at all. It's easy. And it, you know, if it didn't work out great, you know, that's the rub of the green. You know, that's golf. No problem. It's not. So this is just amazing what happened. It's a blessing from God what happened. The key was, I didn't get angry or upset or start thinking all sorts of thoughts like, how dare she do that? Or what's the matter with her? Was she crazy? I mean, this is unfair to me. It ruined my round. It flustered me. It's pressuring me. That, you know, it was, all these thoughts tried to come up. And I just said, whoa, whoa, whoa. Full stop in the wow. I took it positive. I said, well, this is going to be a really, really, really something significant happen. I don't know what. But let me just full stop in the wow of it. This is wow. God is helping me out somehow, and big time. I don't know how, but I will. It will dawn upon me at some point. This is the maturity you want on your path to take everything that happens like this with thank God that everything that happens, thank God for it. Say, thank you, God, for sending your grace to me. And I don't quite understand it right now, but I know I will soon, and it's going to be great. So I'm thanking you in advance. So keep thanking God in advance like this. And so, it's funny, the round matched my clothes. You know, I didn't get dirty, nothing. Spotless round, spotless. And sure, I lost some balls because this is the first time I've done this. But another thing, I never even looked for them. I didn't break a sweat. I just said, ball's gone? Oh, okay, let me drop one. No problem. It happens. Didn't look for a single ball anywhere. Another big change. It's in the bushes. It's in the bushes. Goodbye. Wanted to go there? Let it go there. Not a problem. Also got extremely fortunate a number of times. Well, I thought the ball for sure it's gone. And it ended up hitting a tree and bouncing right into the fairway in a beautiful position. I said, oh, okay. Thank you. And if I couldn't find it, didn't see the ball, I said, ah, okay. Doesn't want to be found. Move on. Next hole. Next hole. Don't sweat it. Don't be, you know. So I never got in a kind of mode where I was like mentally struggling out there. Like, oh, I should have made that putt. Oh, I should have did this. Oh, I should have done. I said, no, everything's just working out great. This is how I expect it to happen, and it's happening just perfectly the way it should go, and no problem. So right now I'm it's kind of a state of shock, actually. 2 hour round. The clubhouse man came out and he said, did you do it? I said, 2 hour round. He said, wow, that is really good. It is good. And I didn't run at all. Just walked the whole time. Didn't try to speed it up. Just smoothly went boom, 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 boom. No practice. So, I get to let this one settle in. And this is a big one. Because again, it reflects the truth. Abidance is giving up practice. And giving up practice is realizing merit is impossible. And when we give up practice, then we move into simply experiencing. And this is what Longchenpa, Jesus Longchenpa, are focusing on. Is Longchenpa keeps saying, basically, hey, just let go of all practice. Let go of all effort. You know, that's the problem. That's what's getting in the way. And of course, most of us, we can't understand. What are you talking about? But it does take a lot of practice to get to the point where you're ready to see that all practice is completely futile. You cannot gain an iota of merit. And so, yeah. Was that lady Anandamayi Ma? Could very well have been. It's funny because just today I said this prayer. So if any of you great teachers are able to appear to me today, are able to appear to me, I will accept your appearance in any form you want it. I had a huge prayer today. I said, I'm at the point now where I will accept you appearing. I will accept your appearance here. Today, this very day. And I meant it, absolutely. I don't care how you want to appear, how long you appear, whether you talk with me, anything. Just appear. That was my prayer today. And this odd-looking being walking along. Wow. She was very disguised. It's like she's wearing a disguise. She was dressed like someone, like a spy, like someone wearing a disguise. That's why I said, who is this? You know, the way she's walking. I said, so what, who? And I almost, like I said, I had this feeling, I need to say hi to this person, which I normally never do. Someone walking on the sidewalk, I'm playing golf. And I decided, I'm going to say hi to this person. Just say, hi, how are you doing today? Because I just felt like I wanted to say hi to them, which is very unusual for me. But somehow she slowed down and was blocked by the sign. And so just like by a second or two, I kind of missed. I said, oh, well. And I turned my back. I said, well, maybe she didn't want me to say hi because she slowed down or something. So if I would have said hi, that would have changed everything. So she didn't want me to say hi. So this could very well have been an appearance of a divine being. And the laughter, again, was I've heard Anandamayi Ma's laughter, and it was quite similar, actually. I mean, she just broke out in peals of laughter. Oh, just, you know, just like it was the funniest thing she's ever seen in her life. And it was very, very fresh and natural laughter. It was so loud, and it wasn't bad laughter. It was just, she was just... This was just delightfully funny to her. I've never heard anything quite like it. And it penetrated my being to a very profound extent. It was an astonishing event, because you just don't come across this on a golf course ever. This was somebody that was unself-conscious about their laughter, about how they acted. Very unself-conscious. A normal person would never have laughed that way at somebody. Never. Wow. You talk about accelerating our path here. It's funny, I was just watching a video last night. A speech, somebody in the Bay Area was giving a speech about on Ananda Mayamaw. It was on a YouTube video. And they went over all these anecdotes of her life. All the amazing, amazing experiences that people, not all, just a few. There were thousands, and maybe hundreds of thousands, or millions of amazing, amazing experiences that people had. That she knew everything that was going on. One of them was someone, she gave a garland, a flower garland, to this little girl. And then the little girl got in the car with her parents and was driving on a dangerous road in India. And the car was muddy, and the car started sliding. It was sliding towards the a canyon river. And it seemed like they were going to die. And the little girl grabbed the flower garland. She said, "Don't worry. This is Ananda Mayamaw's flower garland. Nothing can happen to us." And the car stopped sliding, and they were fine. And then I think some like 6 years later, something like that, this little girl, when she was older, saw Ananda Mayamaw again. And she right away, she said, "Oh, so you're the little girl who grabbed the flower garden in that car." And this is totally normal. I mean, it was just non-stop stream of miracles, actually. Now, they say the miracles that Jesus did, if all of them written down, there wouldn't be enough books in the world to hold them. So we only have heard of a couple of them, a few of them. As far as the written record goes, Ananda Mayamaw's life has more miracles than anyone. The written record of it, we have accounts of it. So I'm not saying that it was more than Jesus at all. It's just that not all of Jesus' were written down by any means. These great beings, those who have been liberated from any belief in merit whatsoever, who are abiding in truth and are completely free of absurdity, they have the capacity to work in a completely miraculous way. So, just driving home here, having gone through an experience like this, you can imagine it's a big wow. But I'm used to it, so you know, full stop in the wow. Remain disciplined. Don't struggle. Don't measure. Don't define. Don't project. Don't try to remember too much. I'm just recounting what happened, but it's... don't overdo it. Don't struggle with it. Don't try to extrapolate what that means for the future. Don't try to place yourself in the future. Stay right in the now. Don't listen to the radio, right? Yeah. And like a 2-hour round like that, I realized, hey, you know, if you're in the desert, you can play early in the morning and be done. You start at like 5:30 in the morning, be done by 7:30 before it gets hot. Or you could tee off late in the afternoon and finish in just 2 hours. Or in the heat, you can play in just a 2-hour round and you don't practice at all. So you don't even break. It's important that you conserve energy in the heat. You know, you get out your, get out of the shade, go to your ball, hit it, go back to the shade right away. You don't. So it's like ideally suited for like desert golf, this type of style also. Or just a very, you know, quick wonderful round of golf. And so again, I'm not going to extrapolate to a next round of golf at all. I'm just going to stay in the wow of this and let it generalize and let it, whatever happens, happen. Don't commit. So this radical Dzogchen is really aimed at dropping all practice. And this is why it said, it's only for the fortunate, very acute few who are able to relate to this without too much fear. It seems counterintuitive. In some way, to absurdity, it's very counterintuitive because we think we're gaining merit. We have to gain merit. Salvation comes through works, especially spiritual practice. And the truth is, it comes through grace entirely. It comes through no practice. So, God bless Ananda Maima, to say the least. Whether it was that was her or not, she's perfectly capable of doing something like that. That's right up her alley. Knowing that I would take it right and it would trigger this essential flipping the script breakthrough, which it did. It's all the grace of God, of course. Yeah. But sometimes the grace of God needs to have a help. It's helpful that it has an appearance of someone to laugh at you on a golf course. And I did a lot of things right. I'll assess things. I need to do like maybe a few things a little better. I had like a protein drink ready to go in the car. So when I got in the car, I just chugged it down right away, immediately. I'll drink some cherry juice later. I hydrated during the round with a protein drink, but with a banana. So I just did all this stuff right and smooth. Picked up my tees and put them by the tee markers. You know, clean up after yourself after you hit the ball. Don't just hit one ball. Don't take practice. Don't practice hitting your ball like after you finish practice putts. Just minimize everything you do out there. Just minimize it. Act like this is just like totally easy for me. Not even bothered at all. My mind's not even bothered in the slightest bit by it. And the course was in just gorgeous shape. Fabulous shape. My gosh. They cut the rough. To some extent. So this was, all in all, an extraordinary experience. But right now, focus on the wow. Focus on the wow. When you have an extraordinary experience, I say, okay, I'm now in the wow of it. I don't want to dig into it too much. I'm able to dig into it a little bit here to give some context, but you have to let it go and now focus on the wow. Because this is the experience we're having now, is the wow. The wow of that. And I'm getting home before it gets dark almost here, which is amazing. I mean, I teed off at 3:47. Done at 5:47. I thought, what am I doing? the Holy Spirit sent me out to the golf course. I said, you got to go. I said, what are you talking about? I'm not going to get there till 3:40. I've never made such a late tee time. At this time, it's still February 24th. I said, I can't tee off at 3:40. How am I going to finish? The Holy Spirit said, no, you got to go. I said, wow. I said, okay, I'm dressing all in white. He said, good. Put on the Ritz entirely here. This is big time. You're going to experience something big time out there. And lo and behold, it worked out as foretold, as the Holy Spirit foretold. Everything's going to work out great, and it's going to be a great, great boost. Holy Spirit, right again. After that torture, three hour plus torture of, oh yeah, it was more than 3 hours. What am I saying? I mean, it's torture, 3.5, let's say, of sitting still in a doctor's reception room with all these corpse-like people suffering. And look at their faces, just the despair on their faces. You know, I'm getting old, I'm dying, my body's falling apart, I'm sick, I don't know what to do. And nobody asked me a question, nobody referenced me in any way. I said, I can help these people. What's going on? No one ever asked me anything here. In my life, it's true, no one has ever asked me anything, asked me for advice or anything, really. Must be a reason for that. I don't know. But it's tough to see people suffering and being chewed up by absurdity. Absurdity just chews us up. Wow. And there's this one club, a 5 hybrid. That just hits it. It just goes. I mean, I don't know what to say. It goes far. Maybe too far. I said, wow. Let me hit this club. I'm getting very confident with these clubs. Let me just hit this. I got a number of clubs that I just feel very confident with. I know if I just swing, it's going to go far, and that's good enough. So there's no hesitation. Just grab it, step up, hit it. The result's going to be pretty good. And if you're not worrying about your score at all, then it gets easier, really. Just don't worry about it. Just go up, step the ball, hit the ball. A lot of times it works out well. So I don't know. Yeah, just wow. And we're going home this beautiful evening. It was like 78 degrees when I think I started there. It's just like 67 degrees at 6:30. And it's just like the sky is just this beautiful dusk glow. And wow. It's just a gorgeous, gorgeous day here. Again, the course was just gorgeous. Lush. And there was nobody, I saw nobody on the course. I never ran across another golfer on the entire golf course. I played 2 hours and never came across anyone. There's nobody there. Because I started at 3:47. Now nobody tees off that late. And so everybody's almost already finished. They're already finished. I never saw another golfer out there. Which was, you know, it's a beautiful feeling. Don't have to stop at all. No self-consciousness. That was something else. Never had a round of golf like that. The ease of it. Just the economy of motion. No struggle. Don't struggle. Don't practice. Don't practice the upshoot of hope and fear. That's a long jump. I mean, like, I'd say, Don't practice. Drop all practice. All practice. All attempts to gain merit. And we will find that incarnating is an attempt to gain merit. Isn't it? That's a form of practicing. Coming to this world is commitment to practicing, actually. All praise to the grace of God to be pointing this out. So, extremely welcome experience. So I'm passing it on here to those who have ears to hear it. Samaya is self-regulating, secrecy, self-regulating, because really, only those who really have ears to hear it can tune into this and really, truly appreciate it. We just assume that Ananda Maima would appear in the same appearance she had when she was here before, so everyone could recognize her, and she'd say, "Hey, I'm back, everyone, and come and see me here. You know, let me set up shop." And we just assume that, but we shouldn't make that assumption at all. Not in the slightest bit. They don't operate that way. She would say, "Well, my appearance in India, that was just a mere appearance. I never identified with this appearance at all. I never identified with the body at all. That was just an appearance for that Indian saga, that epic saga there. But that, you know, this is now. This is here. This is now. So I'm going to appear in any which way that is helpful." These teachers say they never left. She never said that she wasn't going to reappear. Jesus said he would reappear, but we don't know how they're going to appear or what the limits are. I mean, she might have been appearing continuously all over the world and nobody would even know it. Incognito. She liked to travel incognito, actually. She was a genius at it. Sometimes when she didn't want to be recognized, she'd go incognito. And nobody could tell where she was or what she said. She's gone, we can't find her anywhere. So she's very good at going incognito, because they tried to keep tabs of her posse, you know, and they wanted to know where she was every minute, and then she'd disappear, and they couldn't find her anywhere. Nobody had any idea. And then she'd reappear and say, where were you, and she just was quiet, and wouldn't say anything. And sometimes she would say, "Well, you know, I didn't want you to find me, so I changed my appearance, went incognito." And she goes, "When I go incognito, you won't be able to find me, so don't even bother trying." But see, these teachers are not trying to gain any merit. So they know that the body is just mere appearance in an attempt to gain merit. It's a mental projection in an effort to gain merit. It's just a mental projection. So they know it's a mental projection. So they're not trying to gain merit in any way. So for them, they can mentally project any appearance of body appearance whatsoever anywhere. Multiple places, as many as they want. It's no problem at all for them. And then have the appearance disappear. See, they merit is based, trying to gain merit, you have to believe in time. And for them, they don't believe it. They know time doesn't exist. Time, space, process, form, that is all mental projection. So they're not bound to any process at all. So they can just have an appearance appear, and then when the usefulness is done, just disappear. Piece of cake for them. Easy. So, you know, I'm just staying in the wow. I'm not trying to, you know, get emotional about it. So that's part of the discipline. Don't get emotional. I mean, I could start thinking, oh wow, look, what did that really happen? Is that possible? Oh, you know, you can get just real emotional. But no, I'm just saying, okay, I feel a tinge of it, but you know, full stop in the wow. Handle it properly, and stay in the wow of it. And let it generalize. Let it generalize. Stay poised. Keep taking care of business, TCB. Thank you, Elvis. There's some that hope that Elvis is still appearing, yeah, but I don't think Elvis quite had that in him yet. Don't think he had dropped all effort towards merit. But hey, you know, maybe he has by now, you know. He may, but of course he wouldn't appear as Elvis, you wouldn't know, right? So, yeah. Wow. Vehicles, I gotta. Anyway, little humor. So this is just another day here in the world, but it's an extraordinary day. So make your day an extraordinary day. Pray that your day be extraordinary. More than that, remember, I've been praying for everyone, that everyone experience, may everyone experience the wonderful grace of God in the most helpful way possible for them. May everyone experience this right today, right now. Keep hammering away at that type of prayer. Something was responsive to it. Something flipped the script that I was ready for. I was ready to have the script flipped. And something right at the exact right moment catalyzed it. Okay? Now, some people will say sheer coincidence, but if you have a lifetime of this happening, the exact right moment, the opportune moment, when you're ready to have the script flipped, something comes along exactly what's necessary to catalyze it. If you keep calling that coincidence, well, that is an absurdist position. What else is that but absurdity? You have to see that, you have to recognize this is most likely grace of God. You know, that's a better explanation than to say, oh, it's just, you know, sheer coincidence. Sheer coincidence just keeps happening over and over and over in exquisite, with perfect timing. And perfect content and perfect effectiveness, and oh yeah, this is just, you know, complete chance molecules, and yet it keeps happening to the same person over and over and over and over, but no, there's nothing to it. Yeah. that's the least likely explanation, just, you know, bizarrely absurd explanation of it, and yet, well, that's what the world wants us to believe. But We will not struggle with that. We'll stay in the wow of it. You see, if it's just chance, then why full stop in the wow of it? So that's silly. Just move on. Won't happen again. It's an anomaly. Don't read anything into it. Don't react to it. Don't, you know. Well, so you don't practice full stop in the wow. Where the reason why it keeps happening to me is I keep practicing full stop in the wow, so I become ready for the next happening. So those who say it's an anomaly, they say have no reason to react to it in any way and just dismiss it. Well, they don't prepare for the next happening, so it doesn't happen. And then they claim, you see, it was just chance because it didn't happen again. But of course, how do they explain how it keeps happening over and over and over to someone like myself? How do they? They don't. So they just ignore it. They ignore the evidence. Dismiss it. Ignore it. It's just an anomaly. It's not really important. They say, well, statistically, it's not really significant. If it happens over and over to one person, well, yeah, but statistically, if you just average it out statistically, it's not really important. Is that scientific? Or is that non-scientific? It's, right? It's like doing an experiment, and it doesn't work out. Well, it doesn't matter. Let's just, that's not the results we wanted, and let's fudge it here, and let's call it good. And you can't, how can you just sweep it under the rug? So, statistically, it's not significant. So science is nothing more than statistics. And if you have something that doesn't fit at all and completely counters your hypothesis, and to an extraordinary extent, you just say, well, statistically, that's not that important, you know. Because I can find 100 people who don't practice full stop in the wow, who don't have this happen over and over again. And so that just proves that this other is just a bizarre, weird anomaly and statistically is insignificant, so it doesn't impact our theory at all. That's not science at all. All right, very great.